very much, Katharina, for this welcoming words. I'm moved because I have known you almost when you were 10, if I remember well. I also thank you for giving me the courage to address an audience of the Lusians, which is a little bit frightening. I already feel very comfortable. I feel very uncomfortable about the fact that I have to change the topic of my paper. This is due not because I was so afraid of your reaction to Heidegger, but for other unexpected and very urgent work coming in the way. But if you are interested in the topic of what Deleuze owes to Heidegger and how Heidegger in issue concerning thought and how Deleuze tries to overcome some impasses in Heidegger, this is something I still want to pursue. What I'm going to do today is to talk about painting. Let me also say that what I had intended to do and what I'm doing have the same kind of character, namely contextualizing Deleuze. When one is not born Deleuzian, it's like with Heidegger, when one is not born Heideggerian, it's not easy to write on Deleuze or to write on the Heidegger. One way to do that is to use Heidegger and to use Deleuze. A friend of mine once asked Deleuze, are you interested in Heidegger? And Deleuze answered, yes, very much so, but I don't know, je sais pas comment faire. I don't know what to do with it. Clearly one way to write on Deleuze is to do something else with it. And I have heard many papers where this is done. And other way, which is the way I have chosen for this paper, is to contextualize. So to see how Deleuze goes about the problem other philosophers, most of them not unknown to him, but other philosophers would have been unknown to Deleuze, how other philosophers go about the same kind of problem, precisely to understand what the specificity of Deleuze's approach is. And so this is what I'm going to do today, namely to put Deleuze's book on Francis Bacon in context with Saint-Mère Bonty, mainly on Cézanne, and Saint-Michel Henry on Kandinsky. And again, I'm sorry for disappointing those among you who had expected me to speak on Deleuze and Heidegger. It is well known that for Husserl there is no such thing as an adequate visual perception of a thing, because all things appear through partial adumbrations and within a horizon that extends far beyond what is actually perceived. This well-known Husserlian insight can be further articulated in terms of lack and excess that characterize all intuitive vividness of perceptual things. Such a lack and excess make that relation between the perceiver and the perceived is never quite right. This is to say, on the one hand, that the perceiver always intends more than what she really sees. She intends the entire thing and not just fleeting and partial adumbrations of it. According to this first scenario, the lack is entirely on the side of the givenness of the thing perceived, and the excess is on the side of the intentions of the perceiver. So the perceiver sees more than what is given to her. On the other hand, however, what shows itself to the perceiver is always more than what she can grasp. The thing shows qualities and meanings the perceiver didn't expect, and its shining appearance carries a common tale of other possible appearances and other things possibly appearing. In the second scenario, the lack is thus on the side of the perceiver, and the excess, or the excessive richness, is on the side of the appearing phenomenon. Rather than that the perceiver sees more than what is given to her, we now should say the perceiver sees less than what is given to her. It is only a phenomenological epoche of natural life that makes the phenomenologist aware of the interplay between lack and excess that characterizes the correlation between the perceiver and the thing perceived. Depending on the phenomenologist's specific interest, he will then behave according to the first scenario or to the second scenario. A phenomenologist whose main concern is to critically measure her perception and understanding of things against the extent and mode of their intuitive appearing will emphasize that she perceives more than what is actually given to her. Another phenomenologist, more interested in the things themselves and the wealth of their modes of appearing, will be inclined instead to pay careful attention to the excess of thing-givenness and to her own lack of preparation for it. A paper dealing with the possibility and nature of a phenomenology of artistic painting need only be concerned with this second phenomenologist. The first and most obvious question to be asked is then whether performing or submitting oneself to a kind of phenomenological epoche is necessary and sufficient to become an amateur of painting or to become even a painter. Linked to this is then the further question of whether the phenomenology of painting provides a mere illustration for a phenomenological mode of perception, or whether a phenomenologist can also learn something new from closely studying paintings. More insidiously, one must ask whether Merleau-Ponty's account of Cézanne is more than an application of his phenomenology of bodily perception, and whether Henri's account of Kandinsky is more than an application of his phenomenology of pure self-affection. Needless to say, however, neither Merleau-Ponty nor Henri would go so far as to claim that Cézanne and Kandinsky were basically just phenomenologists. Hence our second question. What is it that makes the ways of perceiving of these painters unique? Is there a specific way of perception that we can ascribe to painters? And so what makes the ways of perceiving of these painters unique? And how is this mode of perception related to what and how they paint? What is needed, in other words, to transpose a pictorial mode of perception, so the kind of perception we ascribe to painters, into a painted image on a framed canvas? To reformulate the question, did Cézanne and Kandinsky just paint what they had already seen, or did their paintings make something visible, even for themselves, that otherwise can never be seen? If the latter were the case, then we could not avoid asking also what this invisible that only painting can make visible is like, and how it relates to what we normally see, to what phenomenologists see, and to what painters see. Asking this third question about the invisible properly means that one does not presuppose that the invisible made visible in paintings is of the same nature as the visible in which it is made to appear. In his book on Francis Bacon, Deleuze agrees with Henri that the main object painting is the action and expression of invisible forces and not the enigma of the visible world as Merleau-Ponty had stated it, even if their understanding, Henri and Deleuze, of the nature of the invisible forces active in paintings, in the paintings of Bacon and Kandinsky, differs substantially, just as does their account of the possibility or impossibility to make them visible in painting, Deleuze and Henri also agree that the art of painting is as much a matter of effectivity than visibility. More precisely, the art of painting becomes for them a matter of perceived visible figures and felt affects that are commanded by invisible forces. It was, so far, the introduction. It was Husserl himself who, in a famous letter to the Austrian poet Hugo von Hofmannsthal, first compared the attitude of a phenomenologist to the attitude of an artist. Both the phenomenologist and the artist consider things, persons, events, and the entire world from distance and with wonder. Compared to ordinary people, or to themselves as they behave in ordinary life, phenomenologists and artists have both lost and gained something at the same time. What they have lost is their familiarity with the surrounding world, their spontaneous understanding of the meaning of things, and their capacity to immediately see what needs to be done in all circumstances of practical life. What they have gained is a perception of the world freed from the need, liberated from the need of orientation, a non-instrumental relation to things, and the consideration of worldly events and situations for their own sake. Phenomenological and artistic perceivers have thus changed their own know-how about things and their knowledge of the world for the discovery of the coming forth or birth of both things and the world out of the manifold of ever-changing appearances. It goes without saying, now I start differentiating the perception of the phenomenologist and artist, it goes without saying that attending to the shining beauty of appearances and attending to what they can teach us about the true nature of things is not the same. So there is still a difference between artistic and phenomenological perceivers. But no painter, at the same time, would deny that the contemplation of the beauty of the fugitive formations of clouds in the late afternoon light enriches our knowledge of the landscape. And it is possible that few phenomenologists would deny that describing the multiple adumbrations of old times of the ashtray for the sake of making correct perceptual statements first made her aware of the beauty of this thing. So no good reason to oppose or divide issues of knowledge and of beauty. It also goes without saying that the pictorial epoche and the phenomenological epoche suspend different sorts of prejudices. The painter will have to overcome a schematic scheme of familiar shapes and their distribution in a geometrical space in order to perceive colors just as colors, light and shadows, or empty spaces. The phenomenologist will have to forget all scientific theories about the nature of perception and the physical world in order to see a web of interrelated appearances where others can only see solid things existing in and by themselves. But it is equally true that the painter and the phenomenologist both turn towards the world that is still in the making, and to a making of the world that owes nothing to familiar concepts, scientific theories, and logical laws. Doubting whether this realm of a primitive experience under epoche could still be called the world, Merleau-Ponty has referred to it as brute being, and has untiringly explored the dimensions of its sensible logos. Characteristically, Merleau-Ponty's account of the pictorial epoche, so the epoche that presides over the perception of a painter always has a negative and a positive side. On the negative side, we find Merleau-Ponty's lengthy critical discussions of Descartes' theory of visual perception as a spiritual inspection of colored shapes that are localized in a homogeneous extended space. On the positive side of the pictorial epoche, we find, his characterization of the pictorial epoche, we find Merleau-Ponty's stress on the ambiguity in the appearing of things, on the gaze of things, on the sensible logic of seeing according to, voir selon, and on a perceiving and painting that is in tune with the invisible in the visible things and landscapes. Let us now look at all these elements of a phenomenological, of a phenomenology of pictorial perception, one by one. Ambiguity first. Ambiguity in visual appearances can be illustrated by the fact that we can see, example that Sartre gives, if I remember well in an essay on Giacometti, that we can see both the foliage of a tree and an infinite variety of leaves, both apples with round volumes detached from a table, and the same apples with uncertain contours mixing with a flat surface of a table, both a mountain far away, and the same mountain as part of the surrounding things we can grasp with our hands. In Merleau-Ponty's view, Cézanne, like no other painter, has been able to render these perceptual ambiguities in his paintings. This is not to say that his painted apples, trees, and Montagne Saint-Victoire appear in a way that is as ambiguous as the actual things and landscapes. It also means that as a visible of the second power, as Merleau-Ponty writes, his paintings make us aware of the uncertain and changing modes of appearing belonging to the ordinary things of our perception. We can now see the real mountain as Cézanne has painted it. And when you go to X, you cannot avoid seeing Cézanne all around. We can now see the real mountains as Cézanne has painted it, and we are led to see things that are unknown to him, or that were unknown to him, as he would have painted them. Experience that is familiar to all of us, when we leave the museum, people and even streets and cars can look ambiguously Cézanne-like to us. Merleau-Ponty's theory of perception is also known for having emphasized that seeing is a matter of bodily movements, that our seeing body is simultaneously a body seen, and that, far from perceiving things as objects in front of us, we perceive things from a place among things, and from the inside of a man-man connection of things. Since we are also seen bodies, since all perceivers perceive their body are also bodies seen, no things seen by us can be completely foreign to us. Interesting thoughts, but also a thought that has its limits. Things are not essentially different, or are not different by nature from us, but become different only by the very process of perception that introduces a distance in what naturally hangs together. There is thus, in principle, no good reason why the reversibility that characterizes the relation between my touching hand and my hand touch would not also apply, and this is what Merleau-Ponty has worked out himself, would not also apply to the relation between my perceiving body and the thing perceived by me. This is to say that what I see can also be experienced by me and not by itself as seeing me and as making me feel seen by what I see. between the perceiver and the visible, the roles, I quote, are reversed.
A challenging statement by Merleau-Ponty.
Because one wonders whether such an experience of feeling seen or even gazed at by a perceived table or knife is not a pathological, more precisely, schizophrenic experience. This would, however, only be the case if the thing that see me, that the thing, if the things that see me were to look at me as other human persons. Clearly, this cannot be what Merleau-Ponty has in mind. By quoting painters like Cézanne and Klee at length, he rather wants to make us understand that things in their ambiguous cases or looks invite the painter to have a closer look at them. He also wants to stress that the invitation into this exchange of looks comes from the things and not from the painter. It is thus a dialogue that begins with a question, and where the first question is put to the painter by the things themselves. Time and again, while looking for hours at the mountain that he had been familiar with since his early childhood, Cézanne was struck by the enigma of visibility. He felt there was a lack of coherence in the improbable juxtaposition of patches of color and a lack of unity binding the incompossible elements of stone, sky, trees, and houses together. But he also felt that there must be some insensible logic in the composition of the whole landscape. According to Merleau-Ponty, there was no other way for Cézanne to find out if this was the case, if there was such a sensible logic, despite the disparity of appearances. There was no other way to find out if this was the case than by using his hand, brush, and paint. It was like the mountain had taken hold of his hand, and that the painter and the motive were forming one body breathing together in one rhythmic movement, as Merleau-Ponty formulated, of inspiration and expiration. Merleau-Ponty tries to get a better hold of the sensible logic of the visible, the appearances of which is both ambiguous and enigmatic, things we have just dealt with, through his notion, interesting notion, of seeing according to voir selon. In Iron Mind, one of Merleau-Ponty's most profound philosophical writings, shortest but also most profound philosophical writings, real key to his later work. In Iron Mind, Merleau-Ponty describes how one can see not only the bottom of a swimming pool, but also the cypresses in the garden, the surrounding landscape, and the sky according to the element of the water, or better, according to appearance, to the appearance of the sunlight reflected by the water. Such seeing according to replaces the ordinary seeing as, there what is seen is subsumed under some kind of schema, concept, or category, and thereby immediately recognized and understood in the common way. On the contrary, when one sees trees according to the mode of appearance in which the water presents or shows itself, one exchanges the common understanding of the nature of trees and their difference from water for a new aesthetic experience of the resonance between different fluid colors vibrating in the hot summer light. Put in philosophical language, the aesthetic seeing according to means that every singular thing, or better, every kind of appearance of something that is not a thing any longer, can inaugurate a new mode of seeing related to the entire visible world. So, logically, very interesting thoughts, namely how the visible appearance of a singular thing can become a category to be applied generally or universally to the visible world. Most importantly, a perceiving of the world under epoché completely changes the meaning of the relation between what we call visible and invisible. We have seen that a phenological epoché already makes us aware of the fact that the perception of a visible thing necessarily includes an awareness of invisible aspects of the same thing. Thus, the not yet visible sides of the thing are not just perceived as possibly becoming visible. So don't confuse the unseen backside of the thing with something you could possibly see. You see it, it is involved, it is implied in the very seeing of what you see, which is a statement that one can already find in Husserl. An aesthetic and especially pictorial epoché considerably enriches the range of appearances that make visible the invisible of the visible. Painters do not only see and paint perceptual ambiguities, the interrogative gaze or look of things, the rhythmic resonances between different colors and material elements, the unity of composition in juxtaposed appearances, etc. Painters also see and paint the ordinarily overlooked conditions of these appearances. Lights and shadows, reflections, empty spaces, what is behind and masked by the visible things, how things seem, feel when they are touched, the sound they make when they are heard by another thing. There is, Merleau-Ponty often says, something magical about the art of painting. And like magicians, painters make everything out of almost nothing. But unlike magicians pulling rabbits out of their hats, painters assemble, distribute, and paint invisible no-things, such as the density of particular material, the trembling of the lights, and the ever-receding dimension of depth. The magic art of painting thus suspends the common difference between things and the non-thingly conditions of their visibility, between the visible and the invisible. As the invisible shines through the visible, and as visible things give way to the reflections of lights, the difference between the visible and the invisible becomes undecidable. Or as Merleau-Ponty's image of the chiasma or the Möbius strip suggests, the difference between the visible and the invisible results from a torsion of the same fabric he calls flesh. For the ordinary perceiver, this amounts to no less than a complete revolution of her way of seeing and of the ontological nature of what is seen by her. For what is seen, the ontological difference between things and the mode of being becomes just as uncertain as the difference between the visible and the invisible. But we could also say that painting show how the ontical and the ontological are inseparable or interweaving. In this new seeing of visible things through the medium of ordinary invisible conditions of their visibility, forms will dissolve in shapes, shapes will become patches of color will assemble and separate in a dance to an yet unheard musical rhythm. Next issue. In order to understand what it means to paint, we need to not only account for how the painter transforms our perception into a work of art, we must also return to the difference between the mode of perceiving belonging to the painter and to the phenomenologist. Actually, there are good reasons to think that what distinguishes the perception of the painter from the perception of the phenomenologist is precisely, and very trivially, the fact that the painter wants to paint and not to describe what she sees. The painting must somehow already be present in the painter's seeing even before she starts painting. Somehow. But how somehow? It cannot mean that the painter sees the landscape she wants to paint already as an image, or even that she sees in the landscape what her painting will look like when it is finished. This might, be true for a photographer, but certainly not for the painter. If the painting to be painted denounces itself in the way the painter perceives his motive, it can never be as a visual anticipation, but only as a stimulation to begin painting. Actually, Cézanne and Bacon both emphasize that the origin of their paintings lies in a ruin of the harmonious order of the perceived world, in a kind, he says, he referred to yesterday already, a kind of catastrophe, in their exposure to inhuman and chaotic forces. They are fixed by Cézanne that explicitly make that point. So not only Bacon. Thus, compared to the perception of the phenomenologist, there is less image-like coherence in the perception of the painter, and not more. Painters must see less than other people in order to feel the need or desire to paint. And if there is indeed a close relation between their way of seeing and of painting, this is more a matter of a sense lacking than a pre-given image-like sense to be translated and further articulated. That's a kind of business philosopher's. Rather than painting a pre-given perceptual motive, the painter lends her hand to chance and to its distortion of all subjective intentions and perceptual phenomena preceding the art of painting. Deleuze quotes Bacon, Francis Bacon, saying that as soon as he begins painting, his perceptual clichés and projected images undergo a complete alteration. This has been referred to in another paper yesterday as well, so that the canvas is never empty. As a consequence, the painter is the first one to be surprised by her work and to like or dislike it. Giving room to chance and manipulating probabilities until they give birth to improbable figures, the act of painting is taking the risk that the hand produces works the eye of the artist disapproves of.
Admittedly, the amount of room given to chance and to a painting hand is out of subjective control and actually changes from artist to artist and even from work to work. In his book on Francis Bacon, Deleuze provides a very helpful classification that goes from the absolute chance in abstract expressionism or action painting to seemingly absolute control in abstract painting, precisely painting by Kandinsky. In this scale, Bacon and Cézanne, with their manipulated chance or gauche-germe, hold the middle. Bacon's manual diagrams and arbitrary strokes, his erasings and blurring what he had already painted, never cover the entire surface of his paintings. They thus become regions of canvas invested with particular intensive forces. Diagrams destroy recognizable human forms and change them into figures, figures expressing invisible sensations and forces. Controlled abstract painting in Kandinsky or Mondrian is just another way to do this. It is more radical by departing even further from perception. Natural perception, logical perception, and pictorial perception. It is less radical by leaving no, or at least little room, to chance. The geometrical forms and compositions of abstract painting are governed instead by the necessity of digital code and the logic of binary oppositions. Pollock's abstract expressionism reprints, on the contrary, the other extreme form, namely a form of painting that celebrates mere chance in the expression of completely chaotic forces. Underlying the difference between necessity and chance, and between degrees of abstraction from the perceptual world, there is, however, a common emphasis on the expression of forces shared by these three kinds of painting. For Deleuze, they are all non-figurative because they do not represent the visible world, but rather make visible the invisible forces active in the world, in the universe, or in ourselves. However, even so-called figurative paintings actually, they're not only abstract paintings, actually, I think, owe much less to a mere perception of the world than one is often inclined to think. The perception is at best a necessary, but never a sufficient condition for producing a painting. And this is an issue I will further go into. So, how much painting is actually rooted in perception? It's easy to see that if perception is included in perception, it must be a different kind of perception. How much perception is needed in order so not only what kind, but how much perception is needed in order to paint. In addition to perceiving light and shadows, reflections and color, empty space and depth in the real world, even a figurative painter creates an imaginary world on her canvas. It suffices to think of a painter, not my favorite one, like Ingres, to realize that, strictly speaking, there can be no such a thing as the realistic art of painting. The motive is neither in her mind nor in the external world. Being an inner equivalent of reality, as Cézanne aptly calls it, the motive to be painted is both outside of the mind and buried deep inside the world. Unlike what is inside the mind, the motive can be visually perceived. And unlike what belongs to the external world, not everybody, but only the painter, can see it. A second step in the painter's turning away from reality is accomplished by her concern for the composition of an artistic image. The composition of a painted image, whether figurative or abstract, has constraints that are completely foreign to the context of real things and to the context of the perception of the real world. Composition is about the construction of a totality of a unique image that has its own artificial coherence and visual unity. The totality of a particular painted image is thus essentially different from the natural and general evidence belonging to visual forms or gestalt. A painting is never a gestalt, because a painting never has this kind of spontaneous organization through this perceptual schema of a contrast between figure and background. A painting can thus have many centers of interest or none. It can disclose itself immediately in one global gaze or require a long wandering exploration. Finally, paintings are also unlike the real things of the perceptual world because of the imaginary or fictional character that separates them from the realm of real things. Paintings make an imaginary use of visible elements of the real world, and thereby make us also aware of how much our perception of reality already owes to imagination. One can even say that the frame of a painting that separates its unreal inside from the real outside is both something real and something imaginary. All paintings must have some kind of frame, and frame realize the miracle of showing how undecidable the difference between an imaginary world and the real world actually is. The fact that some paintings suggest that what is in the painting continues in the real world outside of its frame, or that the frame itself is something painted and therefore unreal, doesn't make these paintings more realistic. Quite the contrary, it makes them surrealistic. Think of Magritte. Similar techniques of enframing as well as of deframing the painted image have been part of the art of painting for centuries, and they certainly do not make images more real. They rather make reality look more unreal or fictional. The same can actually be said of the techniques already practiced with great virtuosity by the Greeks of painting a trompe-l'œil. A painted trompe-l'œil never quite deceives an aesthetic eye to the extent that one would take the painted image for something real. The grapes painted by Xerxes only deceive the eyes of the birds, and they are really meant to be a source of admiration for his colleague and rival, Erasmus. Erasmus' way of painting a veil on the wall that makes Xerxes wonder what other painting might be hidden behind this veil is even more impressive and certainly more subtle. Because what Erasmus paints, veil, is an image that evokes the presence of another, even more unreal image. And what his painting eventually suggests is not that something real can be included in a painted image, but rather that all we take to be real is actually mediated in its appearance by imaginary constructions. And this is something I think that is already very much present in Merleau-Ponty and is a central issue in Merleau-Ponty's criticism of Sartre's early account of imagination. The more a painting moves away from the representation of the perceived reality of things and world, the more prominent its task of presenting the hidden forces that inhabit and govern things and the world becomes. It should come as no surprise that philosophers who take the real world to be a battlefield of antagonistic forces are also particularly sensitive to the forces that manifest themselves in paintings and other artworks. Schopenhauer, but also Hegel and especially Nietzsche, immediately come to mind as possible examples. They all take for granted that the essence of art is metaphysical, and that art has the privilege of making visible the same metaphysical forces philosophy tries to think conceptually. As Hegel's philosophy of art shows with particular clarity, such a view involves the risk of turning art into some kind of representation again, instead of representing outer reality by means of resembling imitation or images. painting now becomes, in Hegel, a symbolic representation of the hidden metaphysical forces and, therefore, of the true essence of reality. The art of painting thus runs the risk of appearing as mere servant to a metaphysics that only philosophical thoughts, conceptual thought, and reflection can properly comprehend. If one wishes to avoid this consequence, and if one wishes to preserve the metaphysical relevance of painting, then a new kind of philosophy of painting is required. I shall limit myself here to two examples. One not mentioned yet, Michel Henry's book on Kandinsky, and Deleuze's book on Francis Bacon. Henry first, making extensive use of Kandinsky's theoretical writings, Henry aims to show that for Kandinsky, the metaphysical forces presiding over reality and the spiritual forces expressed in his paintings are identical. Probably well aware of how close this brings him to Hegel's position, Henry also puts a great emphasis on the fact that paintings do not just illustrate or represent metaphysical forces that could be more directly experienced in another symbolic medium, but that they contain these metaphysical forces. Paintings contain the metaphysical forces they express, and there is only one way to experience these forces, namely by feeling them in a pathetic form of affectivity. Actually, according to Henri's radical phenomenology, the being of these metaphysical forces coincides with their self-manifestation or phenomenalization. Kandinsky and Henri both recall what manifests itself to itself and to us in our pathetic feelings are the forces of life. I heard yesterday a paper about the clay, where it is the cosmic forces. But then, of course, Kandinsky and clay were neighbors. We can feel these spiritual forces of life in our ordinary lives, but even better by contemplating artworks that are made especially to express or to create them. For all human forms of experience of the forces of life must, however, be understood as participating in the archy experience that archy life has of itself. Being a movement of effective self-manifestation, life is the immanent and self-effective archy phenomenon we can effectively experience both in art and in our lives. Just as the forces of archy life express themselves in human lives, they express themselves and can be effectively felt in the paintings of Kandinsky. The forces that govern all the pictorial elements and their composition must therefore be identical with the forces that govern the human passions of love and hate, the human affects of joy and sorrow. Being identical means that Kandinsky's paintings do not represent or illustrate human feelings, they are these same feelings. Colors do not imitate an affective tonality, they are cold and warm, bright and obscure. What is difficult, however, to understand in Henri is not that Kandinsky, like most other contemporary painters, and especially Bacon, wants to paint forces, but that the forces contained in his paintings are said to be identical with the force of our affects, and they both must be understood as an expression of the pathetic self-manifestation of archy life. What makes this difficulty look insurmountable is especially Henri's, and let me add, not Kandinsky's, claim that the art of painting is in its very essence nothing else than a mode of this self-affection or intimate self-manifestation of archy life that is said to owe absolutely nothing to visibility, to the conditions of visibility, or to anything visible, such as the appearance of things in perceptual encumbrances. After having tried to make good sense of the claim that painters attempt to make the invisible visible, we now find ourselves confronted with the most implausible claim that Kandinsky's paintings are about an invisible expression of the forces of an invisible life. This is indeed the claim Henri makes. For him, true painting must be abstract painting, because it belongs to the essence of painting to paint what is, in essence, invisible. Thus, the essence of the painted color is said to consist in what it makes us feel like, and not in something we perceive or not, in what it makes. Thus, the essence of painted color is said to consist in what it makes us feel like, and not in something we perceive or in what it makes us see beyond itself. The same holds for, as Henri tries to show, for all other pictorial elements such as point, line, long, or space. The less figurative their use is, the better, because their true essence consists in nothing else than an effective tonality to be felt and never to be seen. In painting, if painting is essentially about the invisible in the sense of something that never lends itself to visual perception, then everything that we have called conditions of visibility also disappears from the art of painting. Painters paint light and shadow, painters painting light and shadow, are thus unfaithful to the essence of their art. They are guilty of fixing our attention on the visible rather than helping us to abstract from it. The paintings by true painters make us forget about things and the world. They concentrate on our pathetic feeling of the forces of life. The forms and colors we see on their canvases become mere occasions for us to feel the affective tonality belonging to the dynamic forces of life. As such, they are, however, not mere visible signs or symbols representing these forces. They really and invisibly contain them in themselves. The presence and affective experience of the invisible forces of life is so strong in the pictorial elements used by Kandinsky that we completely forget about their visibility. In other words, painting becomes music. But if what the art of painting is about owes nothing to the visible and can be equally felt in the way in which we are aware of our own life and of the life in us, then what are paintings still good for? We can break down Henri's answer to this intriguing question in two parts. First, painting does not just express an inner experience we already had of our own life and of Archie life, it is such an experience in its own right. Also, the two experiences are not only equiprimordial, they are essential experiences of the same and therefore only accidentally different. Second, painting and the other art add something substantial, both about the self-manifestation of Archie life and to our pathetic affective experience of life in our lives. Henri never falls short of qualifications for what art adds to life and to its mode, to life and to its modes of self-manifestation and pathetic experience. Fulfillment, exaltation, endless renewal, expansion, intensification, growth of its force, and especially creation of new forces. Paintings thus come from life. Paintings remain in life, and paintings return to life while contributing to its renewal, reinforcement, and enrichment. The price of his pedagogy of art plays for making painting a matter of a real presence and of a creation of the invisible forces of life is, of course, extremely high. This view estranges
painting completely from the realm of the perception of something visible. The identification of paintings, for already the forces expressed in paintings are and remain invisible, also in the paintings themselves. The identification of these spiritual forces with the forces of life that we also feel in ourselves entails also that all paintings must be about forces we humans can possibly feel either by ourselves or by empathy. Ari thus excludes from painting all concern for an infra or inhuman animal and material forces. If paintings can contain some sort of non-human spiritual forces, then for Ari these forces must be supra-human. Also, published 7 years before Ari's book on Kandinsky, Deleuze's book on Francis Bacon, despite agreeing with Ari that painting is about sensation and forces, can actually be read as a successful endeavor to avoid the inconveniences of Ari's view on the essence of painting. In Deleuze's view, rather than transcending all visual perception, as Ari would have it for Kandinsky, Bacon's paintings introduce a new way of seeing and feeling related to new sorts of bodies. What we see in Bacon's paintings is essentially a deformation, not a transformation, Deleuze insists, of human bodies by invisible forces. These forces of deformation dissolve all visible forms. They annihilate all resemblance of painted bodies with the perceptual forms of human bodies and turn them into mere figures. These figures are a purely pictorial element in the art of painting that is not figurative any longer. So, non-figurative figures. These figures are a purely pictorial element in an art of painting that is not figurative any longer, and that has left behind full concern for resembling representation of outer reality. As non-figurative figures, Bacon's painted human bodies are in essence not different from the round, the ring that rotates around them, and from the uniform and neutral background or upland behind them. The athletically or diagrammatically deformed human bodies we see in Bacon's paintings are bodies that express and make visible nothing else than the invisible forces that act on them. They show the process of becoming animal of human bodies that are exposed to inhuman forces. The meat falling off the bones makes visible how physical forces of gravity or acceleration work on human bodies. The animal shadows of deformed human bodies show the beastly suffering caused by injuring forces. The widely open mouth of a pope is a head screaming under the torture of unbearable moral forces. Strictly speaking, Bacon does not actually paint deformed bodies or invisible forces, but what Deleuze calls sensations. Are we then back to Ari's account of non-figurative paintings expressing how we human beings feel the invisible forces of life in the mode of pathetic affection that has nothing in common with the perception of mundane manifestations? Not at all. Deleuze's forces and sensations are very different from what Henri calls by these names. Bacon's forces are not spiritual forces of life and harmony, but material forces of destruction and dissonance. They also do not remain invisible and merely felt, but they become visible through visible sensations. Bacon's works consist thus of visible blocks of sensations that invisible forces create in the very material of painting. Artworks are such blocks of sensations. They create them and they preserve them forever. They make them stand by themselves, as Deleuze writes. Stand by themselves by means of the pictorial material and the composition of the artist. Needless to say,
that such a sensation existing in, that such sensations existing in and by themselves exceed any lived experience of them. To better explain the nature of these blocks of sensations and the way we experience them in Bacon's paintings, Deleuze divides them into what he calls percepts and affects. Percepts are the sensations, as I understand them, that as we perceive them in the material of the paintings, neither perceived bodies nor felt sensations, they are materialized sensations and matter made sensible. Percepts are what remains of perception when neither an object perceived nor a perceiving subject is lived over. Bacon's way of painting attendance, in one, which is to say deformed bodies watching the deformation of other bodies, illustrates well what happens also with the spectator of his paintings. We are all, to some extent, or the spectator of the paintings of Bacon becomes an attendant in his or her own turn. Affects, on the other hand, are the sensations, are they as they affect material bodies, not in how they look, but in how they feel and are changed in their nature by these feelings. Unlike internally filled affections, Henri, these affects are about how invisible forces affect painted figures and how these forces make humans become non-human suffering animals. Bacon's paintings are thus about the deobjectivation of perception and the desubjectivation of affection. This is precisely what happens to the hysteric bodies painted by Bacon. Such hysteric bodies, or bodies without organs, very interesting that shift in the book of Bacon, such hysteric bodies or bodies without organs are bodies that have lost not only their human form, but also all their organic capacities. They are blocks of excessive sensations, pure expressions of an overwhelming presence of the invisible forces to which they are subjected. I come to my conclusion. Put in a very schematic way, one can say that Deleuze and Henri agree in their disagreement with Merleau-Ponty, but then they completely disagree about the proper way to depart from a philosophy of painting based on ephemerology of perception. They agree that the invisible forces the non-figurative art of painting is about do not belong to the flesh of the world, but they totally disagree about what and where they are instead. For only the invisible forces belong to life and not to the world. They can only be felt in us and not seen in paintings. They are spiritually human or suprahuman. Deleuze, on the contrary, thinks that paintings can make visible invisible forces, but that this requires a complete transfiguration of perception, of the perceiver and of the perceived. To perceive how invisible forces act on bodies, the bodies must be subjected to a violent deformation of their recognizable forms and to a blurring of their human signification. Merleau-Ponty's, Deleuze's famous sentence, Merleau-Ponty's flesh is too tender. Actually, it's Deleuze and Guattari. Merleau-Ponty's flesh is too tender. It lacks the bones, the physical resistance, and the structural stability to express and preserve the sensations caused by traumatic exposure to the violence of inhuman forces. But Bacon paints instead of the abstract forms painted by Kandinsky, or of the invisible texture of the visible world painted by Cézanne, are affects and percepts, we already said, which is to say materialized sensations of bodily figures exposed to chaotic and destructive forces. He paints their spasms, their contraction on themselves, and their escape from themselves, which is to say visible forces caused by invisible forces. What we see and what affects us in Bacon's paintings is animal meat suffering from forces that are physical instead of spiritual, that belong to matter instead of life, that come from a cosmos instead of a cosmic harmony. This cosmos is a chaotic reality in which humans have no proper place. What Bacon's paintings are thus about is what happens to humans in an inhuman and cruel reality, a reality without a spiritual meaning and without transcendence and escape. Deleuze's account of painting also differs radically from Henri's thought. From Henri's, through its effort to reduce all reference to subjectivity to an absolute minimum. More precisely, Deleuze denies the creative painter and the spectator of her work any form of transcendence and turns them both into immanent moments of the painting. He also considers the painted work to be a singular and therefore an empirical metaphysical event. Such a pictorial event is not given to an external perceiver. Just as Bacon's attendance, the spectator is involved in the painting and intimately concerned by it. For Deleuze, the abolition of a work of art as an externally transcendent object necessarily also entails the abolition of the artist and the spectator as internally transcendent subjects. A painting of invisible forces can thus withstand, its natural relation to perception only on the condition that this perception is not ascribed to an autonomous and or even absolute subject. So if painting is based on perception, then it is on a very different kind of perception. Similarly, paintings can retain their composition of visible figures, rings and hoplas, if these are not treated as representations of mundane objects, but as pictorial elements created by the action of invisible forces. For Deleuze, the phenomenon of painting thus requires, you're not going to like that, a new kind of phenomenology that takes phenomena just as phenomena, without the thing in itself behind them, and without the subject for whom they are, how they appear to it. It is a phenomenology unheard of by Husserl and Heidegger, because it emphasizes events of manifestation that are essentially contingent and that do not address themselves to a hearing eye. Thank you for your attention. Affects that are commanded by invisible forces. It was so far the introduction. It was Husserl himself who, in a famous letter to the Austrian poet Hugo von Hofmannsthal, first compared the attitude of a phenomenologist to the attitude of an artist. Both the phenomenologist and the artist consider things, persons, events, and the entire world from distance and with wonder. Compared to ordinary people, or to themselves as they behave in ordinary life, phenomenologists and artists have both lost and gained something at the same time. What they have lost is their familiarity with the surrounding world, their spontaneous understanding of the meaning of things, and their capacity to immediately see what needs to be done in all circumstances of practical life. What they have gained is a perception of the world freed from the need, liberated from the need of orientation, a non-instrumental relation to things, and a consideration of worldly events and situations for their own sake. Phenomenological and artistic perceivers have thus changed their own know-how about things and their knowledge of the world for the discovery of the coming forth or birth of both things and the world out of the manifold of ever-changing appearances. It goes without saying, now I start differentiating perception of the phonologist and artist. It goes without saying that attending to the shining beauty of appearances and attending to what they can teach us about the true nature of things is not the same. So there is still a difference between artistic and phonological perceivers. But no painter, at the same time, would deny that the contemplation of the beauty of the fugitive formations of clouds in the late afternoon light enriches our knowledge of the landscape. And it is possible that few phenologists would deny that describing the multiple adumbrations of old times of the ashtray for the sake of making correct perception always more than what she can grasp. The thing shows qualities and meanings the perceiver didn't expect, and its shining appearance carries a common tale of other possible appearances and other things possibly appearing. In the second scenario, the lack is thus on the side of the perceiver, and the excess, or the excessive richness, is on the side of the appearing phenomenon. Rather than that the perceiver sees more than what is given to her, we now should say the perceiver sees less than what is given to her. It is only a phenological epoche of natural life that makes the phenomenologist aware of the interplay between lack and excess that characterizes the correlation between the perceiver and the thing perceived. Depending on the phenomenologist's specific interest, he will then behave according to the first scenario or to the second scenario. A phenomenologist whose main concern is to critically measure her perception and understanding of things against the extent and mode of their intuitive appearing will emphasize that she perceives more than what is actually given to her. Another phenomenologist, more interested in the things themselves and the wealth of their modes of appearing, will be inclined instead to pay careful attention to the excess of thing-givenness and to her own lack of preparation for it. A paper dealing with possibility and nature of a phenomenology of artistic painting need only be concerned with this second phenomenologist. The first and most obvious question to be asked is then whether performing or submitting oneself to a kind of phenomenological epoche is necessary and sufficient to become an amateur of painting or to become even a painter. Linked to this is then the further question of whether the phenomenology of painting provides a mere illustration for a phenomenological mode of perception, or whether a phenomenologist can also learn something new from closely studying paintings. More insidiously, one must ask whether Merleau-Ponty's account of Cézanne is more than an application of his phenomenology of bodily perception, and whether Henri's account of Kandinsky. This is due not because I was so afraid of your reaction to Heidegger, but for other unexpected and very urgent work coming in the way. But if you are interested in the topic of what Deleuze owes to Heidegger and how Heidegger in
Deleuze tries to overcome some impasses in Heidegger. This is something I still want to pursue. What I'm going to do today is to talk about painting. Let me also say that what I had intended to do and what I'm doing have the same kind of character, namely contextualizing Deleuze. When one is not born Deleuzian, it's like with Heidegger, when one is not born Heideggerian, it's not easy to write on Deleuze or to write on the Heidegger. One way to do that is to use Heidegger and to use Deleuze. A friend of mine once asked Deleuze, are you interested in Heidegger? And Deleuze answered, yes, very much so, but I don't know, je sais pas comment faire. I don't know what to do with it. Clearly one way to write on Deleuze is to do something else with it. And I have heard many papers where this is done. And other way, which is the way I have chosen for this paper, is to contextualize. So to see how Deleuze goes about the problem other philosophers, most of them not unknown to him, what other philosopher would have been unknown to Deleuze, how other philosophers go about the same kind of problem, precisely to understand what the specificity of Deleuze's approach is. And so this is what I'm going to do today, namely to put Deleuze's book on Francis Bacon in context with Saint-Mère Bonpontier, mainly on Cézanne, and Saint-Michel Henry on Kandinsky. And again, I'm sorry for disappointing those among you who had expected me to speak on Deleuze and Heidegger. It is well known that for Husserl there is no such thing as an adequate visual perception of a thing, because all things appear through partial adumbrations and within a horizon that extends far beyond what is actually perceived. This well-known Husserlian insight can be further articulated in terms of lack and excess that characterize all intuitive givenness of perceptual things. Such a lack and excess make that relation between the perceiver and the perceived is never quite right. This is to say, on the one hand, that the perceiver always intends more than what she really sees. She intends the entire thing and not just fleeting and partial adumbrations of it. According to this first scenario, the lack is entirely on the side of the givenness of the thing perceived, and the excess is on the side of the intentions of the perceiver. So the perceiver sees more than what is given to her. On the other hand, however, what shows itself to the perceiver is more than an application of his phenomenology of pure self-affection. Needless to say, however, neither Merleau-Ponty nor Henri would go so far as to claim that Cézanne and Kandinsky were basically just phenomenologists. Hence our second question. What is it that makes the ways of perceiving of these painters unique? Is there a specific way of perception that we can ascribe to painters? And so what makes the ways of perceiving of these painters unique? And how is this mode of perception related to what and how they paint? What is needed, in other words, to transpose a pictorial mode of perception, so the kind of perception he ascribed to painters, into a painted image on a framed canvas? To
reformulates the question. Did Cézanne and Kandinsky just paint what they had already seen? Or did their paintings make something visible, even for themselves, that otherwise can never be seen? If the latter were the case, then we could not avoid asking also what this invisible, that only painting can make visible, is like, and how it relates to what we normally see, to what phenomenologists see, and to what painters see. Asking this third question about the invisible properly means that one does not presuppose that the invisible made visible in paintings is of the same nature as the visible in which it is made to appear. In his book on Francis Bacon, Deleuze agrees with Henri that the main of painting is the action and expression of invisible forces and not the enigma of the visible world, as Merleau-Ponty had stated it. Even if their understanding, Henri and Deleuze, of the nature of the invisible forces active in paintings, in the paintings of Bacon and Kandinsky, differs substantially, just as that's their account of the possibility or impossibility to make them visible in painting, Deleuze and Henri also agree that the art of painting is as much a matter of effectivity than visibility. More precisely, the art of painting becomes for them a matter of perceived visible figures and filled